Brooklyn Independent Television.
Neighborhood Beat is made possible with generous underwriting support from the Brooklyn Cyclones. Tickets are on sale now. For information, 718-507-TIXX or on the web at brooklyncyclones.com. The Cyclones are Brooklyn.
Hello, welcome to Neighborhood Beat, your passport to Brooklyn. I'm your host, Aaron Watkins, and today we are back in the neighborhood. We'll practice our sketching skills at Brooklyn Art Library. Next, paint cool ceramics at the Pottery Studio, Baked in Brooklyn. We'll shop at cutting-edge multi-retail space About Glamour before we dine on absinthe and oysters at Maison Premier on Bedford Avenue. Stay tuned. Like all of New York City, this neighborhood has seen many changes in its ethnic population, especially at the turn of the century. With the opening of the Williamsburg Bridge in 1903, thousands of Lower East Side Jewish people crossed the bridge to a better life in Williamsburg. Between 1900 and 1920, Williamsburg population doubled with immigrants from Eastern Europe, Lithuania, Poland, and Russia. Italian immigrants settled on the north side, many from the town of Nolany, where the Festa del Giglio originated, which is still practiced today. Imagine a place where you get to express yourself on paper while contributing to a growing library of art stories through sketchbooks from around the world. You also get to view the stories of others, either online or, conveniently enough, right here in Williamsburg. Well, it's real, and the collection houses over 15,000 sketchbooks. Welcome to the Sketchbook Project at the Brooklyn Art Library.
Hey, my name is Steven Peterman, and I'm the co-founder and director of operations of Art House and the Sketchbook Project. The Sketchbook Project is located in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, here at the Brooklyn Art Library. The Sketchbook Project is thousands of people getting together to create a mobile library, which then eventually will be housed in Brooklyn, New York at the Brooklyn Art Library.
So the Sketchbook Project is open to everyone. You can either sign up through our website at thesketchbookproject.com or come to the Brooklyn Art Library and get your book in person. You choose what kind of book you want to create. It could be a chapbook, a travelogue, a normal sketchbook. You fill it up and send it back to us, and then we'll take it around the country after we archive it. And then it'll be, after the tour's over, it'll permanently be residing in the Brooklyn Art Library. The Sketchbook Project is all community funded. It costs $25 to participate. That covers the storefront, the tour, and the supplies for the book. The Brooklyn Art Library currently has around 12,000 sketchbooks archived here. When the 2012 tour is completed in November, we'll have about 22,000 books, and we've got them from all over the world. I think there's been about 120 different countries that participated in the project so far. And we are clearly going to need to build more shelves. The Sketchbook Project was established in 2006. Since then, we've sent out about 40,000 sketchbooks to people from around the world, and we've issued about 40,000 library cards as well. It's free to come in and browse through all the books.
It's very interesting to see. We haven't seen it probably even made a dent in the 20,000 that there are. We've just looked at a few, and they were pretty nice. The use of texture was probably the most interesting, that you could give someone a book and then people turned it into tapestries and different paintings and sketches, and it's really not sketches, it's all sorts of different things.
So the first step to look at books is to get a library card. You can do that right over here. I've already got mine, so I'll skip this step. Go over to the checkout station. From here, we can search for different sketchbooks to look at. You can browse by location of the artist, the format they use for their book, what materials were used, their occupation, things like that. For right now, I'll just get a random book. And then back there, there's runners that go around, and they'll have a little app on their phone that tells them which books to pull for me. Chris has two right here.
All right, here you go. You got one from Singapore and one from Bulgaria.
Thank you, Chris. And now, as these books were just checked out to me, the artist just got a notification on their text message or an email telling them that their book's being viewed. I'll just come sit down and look at them.
This is my first time actually at the Brooklyn Art Library, and I came here for the sketchbook artist project. I came to this place to see a sketchbook by a friend of mine. Her name is Nalin Pereira. She lives in Bali. She's a Malaysian, and she's a best friend of mine. And just want to show you that the book is called Within, and she actually specially made for the project. To me, the book seems very personal and very full of energy because of the color that she uses. The book itself talks about happiness, peace, and freedom, but most importantly, it's about love, something that she's been searching for.
Sketchbook project idea basically came from the concept that everybody should be able to participate in art. Back when we were sophomores in art school, we really wanted to get involved in the gallery scene. We wanted to show our work, and we just didn't know how, and we felt intimidated by it. We felt like that was just not the way the art world should be, and we kind of set out on this mission to create the anti-gallery, the opposite of what everyone thought of as a gallery. And so we created Art House and started creating these projects where anyone could participate and sign up, and none of the work was juried, and everybody got a chance to come to the show and be excited and have kind of their first art experience, or maybe their 100th art experience.
The sketchbook project is kind of, in essence, an experiment, an ongoing collaborative group project where people from all over can participate. And so in that spirit, we do other one-off projects and taking different forms. So we did a video project, we did a photo one, we did one where we would give people a blank, an empty jar, and it was up to them to fill the jar, and that was called the Jar Project. The project itself, who knows how it's gonna change. We're always kind of experimenting and seeing what works and trying new things with it.
Man, I love my neighborhood. Why? Because there are so many interesting things to see and do. So, here are 10 fun things for you to check out while still supporting your local economy. You can learn to be a stunt person at Hollywood Stunts. Get an eco-friendly bike from Carbon Negative. Learn a new language at Fluent Brooklyn. Learn to greenify your apartment with a visit to Sprout Home. View quirky exhibits at City Reliquary. Sample home-style Mexican cuisine at Mesa Culiacan. Pick up some Polish goodies at Serena Bakery in Greenpoint. Learn a new craft with Katie and Moni at So Moni. And get everything you need, including lessons, to make your own jewelry at Brooklyn Charm. Then you can end the day by sipping on locally fermented wine at BK Winery. I mean, woo! That is a lot. One thing is for sure, Brooklyn ain't boring. So come and check us out. So you're not an artist and you don't own a kiln, but you love pottery and you'd love to be able to make your own, right? Well, if the thought of making that pot from scratch seems a little daunting, then simply come here and paint one at Baked in Brooklyn. You pick it, you paint it, they bake it. Voila.
Baked in Brooklyn is a craft studio where anyone can come in and create something beautiful. The idea for Baked in Brooklyn came about when I was laid off from my normal job. I was a researcher. I was doing research at Mount Sinai on children's neuroscience. And I was looking for something else to do, and I didn't want just another paperwork kind of job. We offer a selection of activities, including painting pottery, which is the main thing that we do, but we also have ceramic classes. We have adult craft nights, which feature different activities, including mosaics.
My name's Sarah Azanero, and I work at Baked in Brooklyn, and today we're gonna talk about mosaics. This is what I've been working on. It's a mermaid mosaic. We like mermaids here. We also have a sun and a moon. We do coaster sets. Sometimes we have mosaic nights. So for mosaics, the first step is to cut the glass. And then after you have your glass cut, cut, you can start putting it in a pattern. What I like to do is I like to draw out a pattern and just follow that. So here I've been doing the wave pattern, so now I'm just gonna fill in this area here. So it's kind of like a puzzle, or like Tetris, the game Tetris. You just fill it in wherever it can fit in.
I live in the community, and I thought about things that were needed here, and a place where people can come and do art in a non-judgmental environment that's really often fun and caters to groups especially. So Williamsburg seemed like the perfect spot to do this. Just there's a lot of creativity, a lot of energy, a lot of youth in the neighborhood.
This is part of the adults hand building class. And I'm gonna do a simple demo of a soap dish. I started off with paper cutouts. So I'm transforming a 2D piece of paper into something 3D. So this was a cutout for the middle piece. It's actually gonna hold soap. I teach kids and adults classes at Baked. We start out from age 4 and range up to age 104 when necessary. So we do a very wide range. It's very fun for me to teach people ceramics. I think I learn more from my students sometimes than they learn from me, which is, I think, the good thing about being a teacher. It's very fun. It's interesting meeting people with all different types of backgrounds. So they think of ideas that I've never come up with, and I show them technicalities of how to do things, and it's very fun. We will score and slip another sharp object, and we pretty much draw an X in the clay. And this is how you quote unquote glue clay together. And then you can use slip or water, kind of pinch it together. I'm actually skilled and educated in a lot of different mediums, a lot of different materials. I choose clay because I think it's the most fun to work with. It's safer than a lot of different materials, and it's a 3D white canvas. Let it set up a little bit so it's a little bit stiffer, so it's not so flimsy, and that's gonna sit right in here. I think ceramic arts are really popular in the city, especially New York. As far as the art scene goes, it's very painting driven, very Chelsea gallery driven, which is really great, but for people that don't work on that scale or that level of art, they can just come in and be a part of it at a much calmer, relaxing level. And this is a soap dish.
The process when people come in is they choose a piece, they design and paint their piece, and we help them out with that. All of the pieces are bisque items, and so when they come and choose a piece, the piece has already been fired once. And when I say fired, that means that it's been cooked in the kiln. So this is a ring holder that has been painted, and you'll notice that it's all green. All of the pieces, after people paint them, we dip in a clear overglaze, and that makes sure that they're all shiny and completely food safe when they come out of the kiln. So the glaze that we use turns everything green, but the green turns clear once we put it in the kiln. So this is one of our kilns. We put all of the pieces in the bottom of the kiln like this, and then we load the whole shelf until it's full of pieces, and then we use these. These are called kiln posts, and we rest them inside, and then we add shelves on top so that we end up with a tower of ceramics until the whole kiln is full. The kiln goes up to 828 degrees every time that we fire. The process takes usually about 18 hours to start and fire the kiln until it cools down. When people come in, they usually have to come back in about 3 or 4 days to pick them up. I have been working in clay since I was like 10 years old, and so it's been something that I've always enjoyed doing, and so branching out and starting this business kind of gave me the chance to indulge an endeavor that I have always been interested in. I think what sets us apart is that our studio really has a really positive vibe. The energy is a great asset for us. We have people of all ages. We have excited adults who just, you know, in the course of a normal day, don't necessarily have the chance to do something that's artistic, that's creative, and that is fun. It's not like a run-of-the-mill, oh, it's all a bunch of kids in there and I just want to get out. It's really noisy and stressful. I think it's a place people come to relax and have fun.
About Glamour collects hard-to-find vintage living wear, clothing, and accessories and brings them all here for you to peruse and hopefully find the nostalgic moments of glamour in your life.
My name is Takeshi Iida. We are About Glamour, Williamsburg in Brooklyn. About Glamour is a Japanese vintage store with art gallery. We opened since September 2003. We almost carry Japanese vintage stuff, not only Japanese, but also Europe stuff, and Japanese stationery and knickknacks. We decided to open because after 2003, we couldn't find actually the clothing what we loved or what we want to wear at the time. So we would like to open to carry the clothing what we would like to wear. Our customers are like 20s and 30s, which is really fashionable people who is looking for something like unique, different from others. Because we carry the Japanese stuff, which is it's not easy to find in United States.
I look at everything because I'm like a total Japanese nerd. So like I love all the stickers and the stationery and whatever, but I'm also a vintage wholesaler and their vintage selection, like the curation that they do, there's a very specific Japanese style to buying vintage. It's very, very specific and I love it, and I'm small, so I love what they do. So I kind of, this is a really, really great place for me to shop for clothes as well. And if you're looking for that Japanese vintage aesthetic, like I already saw Vivienne Westwood, like it's right there when you walk in. They always have that kind of stuff, which I love.
We have curators, and the curator always choose or pick the artists from all over the world. I think artwork make us feel exciting or feel something different thing, or artworks make me experience something different from the, you know, ordinary lives. And so I would like customer to do feel experience those kind of artworks. I love artists, and I always think that the artist, when I pick the clothing from Japan or from Europe, for example, Picasso wore stripes anytime, so that's why we carry the stripes a lot.
My name is Michael Kobayashi, and I am a fashion and art editor at About Glamour. So at About Glamour, we sell a bunch of handkerchiefs like these, colorful leggings, and fancy bow ties, which is from Japan. We carry both the vintage and new accessories that are for women. The earrings and the necklaces are from Japan. And here's old brooch, and these are dolls. This is made of clay. On these two lockets from Japanese designers.
I like the unique clothing that they bring in from Japan. I've been buying their clothing for a long time, and the little knickknacks, like the stickers and the chopsticks, and everything is just very unique. And well, to me, it's a little bit like coming into a Japanese store, like a little cute craft store and clothing store. And I'm half Japanese, so I really enjoy having something like this in the neighborhood because it makes me feel a little bit more like I'm at home, if that makes any sense. And it's unique. Like, you can't get a lot of these things anywhere else in the neighborhood, so it's really nice to have a little bit of Japan here.
Williamsburg is really laid-back space. It's not so quick like Manhattan. So it's like my style. I think at that time I I thought that I fit here. That's why I like it. Our goal is to keep open this place, and we would like to not to make our store bigger, because most of our customers are really closer neighbors. So that's why we would like to keep our store unique or different. That's all we want to do right now.
And now, let's check out Maison Premiere with Caroline Shin.
This is Maison Premiere, serving up that special pairing of oysters and absinthe and a taste of New Orleans. I'm here with co-owner Joshua Boise, who's going to give us the inside look.
Let's go and check it out.
Let's go.
So the concept for Maison Premiere came from the oyster saloons of America. Turn of the century, early 1900s in New York, there were tons of little bars that were called oyster saloons. And so they were tiny little taverns that had a nice little oyster menu that would go with the ales. And the Hudson and East River were at that time loaded with oysters, so it was one of those things that was pretty common. And so some of our history dated back to the original oyster taverns in New York. And then there was this other part of the story, which was New Orleans and the history of New Orleans and the architecture and the French inspiration, which came into play with building out the entire space. There's a little bit about the place that you'll probably recognize from some of the cafes in Paris, the Horseshoe Bar, the Pink Marble. So those are some of the elements that started to lay the foundation for what became this kind of French-inspired American tavern.
So could you tell me about the artwork here?
Sure, we have this one painting that I really like, which to me is really symbolic of all the research and history of New Orleans, and that's of Napoleon. It's an original oil painting from the late 1800s, and the Napoleon House restaurant and bar was built in the 1700s for him to exile and receive him, which he obviously never made it, which is now one of the oldest bars and restaurants in the United States. The interior of the bath is basically a replica of some of the bathrooms you'd find on old steamboats in Mississippi and New Orleans. So this is an exact replica of what the bathroom would have looked like. The sink actually came from an old steamship in the 1890s. And we had to find some antique restoration workers who specialize in antique plumbing. It was a 2 to 3 year process from start to finish of hunting down everything and restoring everything. So one of the items that we replicated was this, because we felt it was going to be our centerpiece and so important to the absinthe story that we were trying to bring back to life. We purposely made it the centerpiece of the bar so everyone understood what our main focus was, and that was absinthe and absinthe cocktails. This is a soapstone base. In terms of the body of the statue here, it's the green jade marble, it's Italian marble, and then there's a bronze Napoleon figure on top, which was actually created by the same sculptor that sculpted the ones for the Napoleon House. The spouts are brass, and then there's a medallion for decoration. Wasn't an easy process, but today it's working, and it's our centerpiece for our absinthe program, so we're really excited about it.
I see that you also have a very old-timey wardrobe. Where did that come from?
I really wasn't into wardrobe too much until Maison Premiere opened, and then we realized the impact that it had on the community and on New York. And I think it's important to understand who we are and what we're doing here. And part of that is bringing back this kind of American lifestyle of dressing up and taking pride in the way that you look and the way that you go out and the way that you consume. And so the wardrobe for me, especially as the owner of Maison Premiere, was to set the standard for who we are and what we do. And we go to work with bow ties and we wear suspenders and we have handmade hats. We really care about where our clothes come from and our products come from. And so I felt that it was a really good sign of who we were for me to represent the brand.
So, what exactly is absinthe?
Absinthe is it's a very historic spirit to Europe and the U.S. It was first developed as a medicinal recipe in Switzerland and went commercial in France. It's a neutral grape, neutral grain, or neutral beet spirit. It has to have wormwood, fennel, lemon balm, hyssop. Absinthe cannot have any sugar, extracts, coloring, or oils. It must be all natural.
Let's try making some absinthe.
Yeah, let's do it. We're going to use the Delaware Phoenix absinthe. This is from upstate New York. That's good. Yeah. Okay. It's a little bit high, but it's not too bad.
All right.
So I'll take this one over here. So as you can see right here, the sugar cube has already been dissolved. So I'm going to start this one over here. All right, so these are finished. Here we go. In these cafes, they would print the prices of the absinthe on the plates. And so when you had another absinthe, they would stack the plates.
Oh,
And so as you drank more over the afternoon, your plates would get higher and higher. And so that way, you know, you don't really have to keep track so much of like what you owe. One of our most popular absinthe cocktails at Maison Premier is the Imperial Opal. For this cocktail, we use the Tennyson, which is a French blanche. We are going to do 1.25 ounces of the Tennyson. Next ingredient is a Spanish anisette called Chinchon. 1/2 ounce of yellow chartreuse. 1/2 ounce of a rich, simple syrup. And then 1 ounce of water. We're gonna add some ice, drops of rose flower water over the top. Squeeze some lemon oil right over the top. And that's the Imperial Opal.
I'm here with Christoph Ziska, who's gonna show me how to shuck oysters.
It took me a while to learn about oysters, how to open them, because I would be like using all my strength to open oysters. And that was the hinge there that we opened the oyster. So now this is the top shell here. So cut the adductor muscle, and then the shell's just gonna come off. Oysters change every season, during the season, so they change a lot in taste. What's really cool, you can see there's a lot of liquor. We're always looking for, of course, the shell. We like the shell to be really hard. We're looking for liquor, the juice of the oyster, and the meat of the oyster. That's what I'm looking for every day. Then we're going to just put the knife underneath and to cut the bottom part of the adductor muscle.
I'm going to go for it. I'm going to try to shuck an oyster.
Just diving right in for it. So you're going to get the hinge here. Try to put it down a little bit more if you can. Just toggle it back and forth with the knife. So you go in, and then you're almost there. You're like so close. There you go. See how easy that was? Wipe the knife down a little bit, because you're getting a little bit of shell, and then you're going to cut across the top shell there and cut the abductor off. There you go. You just shucked a perfect oyster.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, that does it for this episode of Neighborhood Beat, your passport to Brooklyn. I hope my visit will inspire you to check out Williamsburg and neighboring Greenpoint for yourself. To learn more about us and watch past episodes, visit us at brickartsmedia.org/BIT. You can also download episodes on iTunes and friend us on Facebook and Twitter. Keyword, BK Independent TV. We'll see you next time. One love, Brooklyn. Cheers. Yes. Oh, what a beautiful day.
Neighborhood Beat has been made possible with generous underwriting support from the Brooklyn Cyclones.
Follow us on Twitter @BK Independent TV.